Congressional Campaign Committee. Congressman, thanks so much for being here.
It's good to be with you, Megan.
All right, so read those tea leaves for me. Let's have it straight. Is reconciliation the next step for the Democrats if no deal results from yesterday?
Well, if there's no deal moving forward, then, as the president said, we're not going to allow health care reform to be held hostage to foot dragging. And so, again, assuming that we can't put together something where there is agreement, we are going to proceed. Now, that doesn't mean that some of the ideas that were discussed yesterday are not incorporated into the legislation. I mean, for example, there were some additional ideas on how we can protect consumers and the Medicare program against fraud. Those should be added. And so a number of things could be added, some could be subtracted, but at the end of the day, what the president's saying is that we do need to move forward on comprehensive health care reform this year, that baby steps are not sufficient to address what is a very serious problem, especially with these rapidly rising premiums that people are experiencing, 39%, 45% increases. It's just not sustainable.
And just to clarify what I meant by reconciliation for our viewers, most of our viewers know, but it's where this would be passed in the Senate, if at all, by a 51 vote instead of 60 votes, which has raised some controversy. And let me ask you about that, because, you know, people listen to that and they hear you say, yeah, okay, it's on the table. You know, that's the route we'll go if we can't reach a deal. And they say, okay, reconciliation has been used in the past, but it's mostly a budgetary measure, not something that's speaks to a huge health care initiative, and something that speaks to one-sixth of our economy. To have no bipartisan support would really be stunning. That's the argument on the other side. How do you respond?
Right. Well, first of all, it has been used many times in the past, including for a very comprehensive policy change when we went through welfare reform. It was used twice by President Bush to pass a big tax cut that disproportionately benefited the very wealthy. So the argument is that if you can use it for things that benefit just the very wealthiest of our country, why shouldn't you be able to use it to protect middle America from rising health care premiums?
I'll jump in one second, then you can make your point.
All right, go ahead.
Robert Byrd, who's a Democrat, who's the one who came up with this procedure, and the Senate historian, has said, he's a Democrat, and he has said, for you guys to use reconciliation for this would be, and I quote, an outrage. He says it's wrong. It was never intended to be used this way. You got the floor.
But Robert Byrd said when the Republicans used it for certain things that it was an outrage. And the Republicans used it on many different occasions, again, for both policy measures as well as budget measures. Now, you asked me about using it for this particular issue, health care. It's budget reconciliation because it's intended to be dealt with things that have a big impact on our budget. As you pointed out, health care probably has the largest impact, not only a big impact on the economy, but it is the number one driver of federal deficits and the federal debt. So using budget reconciliation, which, as the CBO, again, the referee, the nonpartisan CBO, has said, would reduce our national deficit and debt both over a 10-year period and a 20-year period, is the kind of thing that budget reconciliation is intended to do.
Okay.
And let me just make the final point, Megan. Here's the point I want to make, though. Because all the Republicans have to do.
Let me get this last question in, and then you can make your point. Now, listen, you can't filibuster when you come on. Let me get that last question in, and then you can answer, okay? My question is, the latest polls that we just got out of Fox News show that Congress now has a 14% approval rating. 14%. And many folks are asking, with those kind of numbers and what we saw in Virginia and Massachusetts and New Jersey, whether it's going to be a bloodbath, in particular for Democrats, if you guys muscle this thing through against the will of the American people, because the polls show 70% don't want the current bill as styled in Congress. It's all yours.
What the polls show, and if we want to go by polls, is if you ask people about the different elements in the plan that's been put forth by the President and the Congress, they like the elements. Prohibiting people from being denied based on pre-existing conditions, lowering premiums, making sure we cover more people. People like that. Things like that Nebraska deal that got in the Senate bill that should never have been there, understandably, ticked people off. It ticked a lot of us off. That's going out. We're making other changes. But at the end of the day, one of the reasons people are frustrated with Congress is that we're not able to move forward on these things because there's been so much obstructionism. And I'll just end with this question. The only reason you have to consider using this budget reconciliation measure, which is majority rule, is because our Republican colleagues won't let an up or down vote, like a majority, like it says in the Constitution. You need 51 votes to pass a bill in the United States Senate and in the House.
It was something, you know, we played a soundbite yesterday. It was something that then Senator Obama opposed when the Democrats were on the other side. It was something Hillary Clinton did, Joe Biden did, and you know, we'll see whether it gets used. It's very interesting. Anyway, we appreciate you coming on, Congressman. All the
best
to you, Chris Van Hollen.
You too.
Thanks so much.